presents the life of the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace be upon him. A lecture series by Mufti Ismail ibn Musa Mink. Episode 12, Hijrah, Migration.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We commence as always by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending complete blessings and salutations upon the masterpiece Muhammad ibn Abdullah. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon him, his entire household, and all his companions, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all, and may he bless every single one of us and grant us goodness. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, it is important that before we commence, we make mention of a few points regarding the seerah or the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are many books that have been compiled about the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some of them are in a story form, and some of them are in narration form. Some of them have made mention of just a story, so from the beginning to the end, according to some chronological order, the story is mentioned so people can read it and they can learn a lesson from it and understand it. But if we were to look deeper, we would find that those who have written it in story form, they have gathered it from somewhere where narrations have been made mention of. Some of these narrations are made mention of by companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and some of them by historians. Now you and I know that in Islam, whenever we want to utter something, we need to ensure that we have a chain of narrators going back to the source of the story, to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or to the one whom it had happened to. So we will find exactly how it happened. If there is a problem in the chain of narrators, nowadays it is very, very easy to tell that this is a weak narration and that is a correct narration, authentic narration, and so on, because we have all the data in a small little chip or in a disk or on a website. If we would know how to search, we would be able to look if someone is telling a lie or not, because it's quite easy to find out that this person is claiming to have heard from someone who died before they were born, so that's a lie. Or this person is claiming to have heard from someone who never ever visited them and they did not visit them. So you would know there is a problem there. Or there is a person who is narrating and he is saying that I heard from so and so, but he was known amongst his people as a liar. In that particular case, we cannot base our deen on that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So what I have tried to do is to make mention of that which is authentic. And as you know, as days pass, we authenticate even more. And if it is found that we have also said something which is not authentic, then we would revise it to excuse ourselves to say this is not authentic, or we found that this was not correct, and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. The reason I say this, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the highest of creation. We don't doubt that. He is the most blessed. He is the most honored. He was loved and favored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most, but he is still a creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the highest of all creatures. We know he has the highest status with the truth that we know about him. So why should we lie in order to raise his status? Do you think is going to make him any more important when he is already the most important? So there is no point to lie. Sometimes people have a disease. When we tell them this is wrong, they automatically start getting excited and angry to say, no, 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 you have blasphemed and you have done this. No, that's not the case. Nobody is denying that he is the highest. Nobody is denying his status. Nobody is denying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored him. But all we are saying is, this is an authentic narration. It has been made mention of. And what others are making mention of is either fabricated or is not as authentic. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Remember, the winner is he who follows that example. The winner is not he who barks all day and night. The winner is the one who follows the example. You know, they say, put your money where your mouth is. Allahu Akbar. Which means you want to talk big, put it, let's see. May Allah protect us. May we not be from amongst those who pay lip service without following His example, without emanating what He has come with. May we not be from amongst those who claim to be His followers, yet we don't read salah. We have bad habits of adultery, fornication, gambling, smoking, and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from such habits. I see the brothers are frowning at me when I said smoking. Don't we agree it's a bad habit? Come on. Month of Ramadan, can't we give up one major bad habit of ours every Ramadan? Wallahi, we would be from amongst those who've given up 30, 40 bad habits by now if we just gave up one major habit every Ramadan. When the doctor tells you, listen, you've got to give up smoking because if not, this will happen, that will happen, we throw it out. We know it's a bad habit. We're not talking about haram and halal and makruh and so on. We're talking of whether it's a good habit or not. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empower us to understand that following the example of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam requires willpower, it requires iman, it requires a genuine iman and the understanding of the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I'd like to start off by saying that it was brought to my notice that yesterday and perhaps previously, on some occasions, instead of saying 5 years from the prophethood, I said 5 years of hijrah. And I'm sure you would have picked that up, like when I made mention of the marriage of Sauda binti Zam'a radiallahu anha. By mistake, I said 10th hijri. And I said that's the same year that Khadija binti Khuwaylid radiallahu anha passed away. Well, you would understand that that was 10 years from prophethood because hijrah had not yet taken place. That was just a slip of the tongue. I thought it was only correct for me to correct that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. We had also made mention of the way Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, one of the leaders of Aws, had accepted Islam when Mus'ab ibn Umair was there with As'ad ibn Zurarah radiallahu anhum. And we made mention of how Usayd ibn Hudayr radiallahu anh had gone up to them trying to stop them. And when Mus'ab ibn Umair spoke to him, he accepted Islam. Moments later, the same happened with Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. There is a point of detail that is important for me to mention. And that is, when Sa'd ibn Mu'adh accepted Islam, he got up to his clan. Who were they? They were known as Banu Abd al-Ashhal. He got up to them and he said, "Oh Banu Abd al-Ashhal, I am not going to speak to any one of you, neither male nor female, until you accept this man as a messenger." They all accepted without exception. Subhanallah. So this shows when the chief accepts, the rest of them follow. This was Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu anhu. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson from his entire life. We will come back to this man inshallah when we make mention of the wars that took place at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then there is an important story that we touched on, and I think we need to mention a little bit of detail. The marriage of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Aisha radiallahu anha. Khawla binti Hakim radiallahu anha had made mention to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of marrying Sauda binti Zam'a. And she also made mention of marrying Aisha, the daughter of your best friend, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So she went to Ruman, who was the wife of Rasulullah, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Khawla binti Hakim went to her and made the suggestion. She spoke to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu and they agreed, subhanallah. They were happy. Although initially Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu made mention of a point. He said, when this girl was young, I had promised her to Jubair ibn al-Mut'im ibn Adi. And this man is still a mushrik. Let me go to them and see. When he went to Jubair ibn al-Mut'im, when he went to al-Mut'im ibn Adi, the father of Jubair, and spoke to him and his wife, the wife quickly uttered words that my son is not going to leave the forefathers in order to marry your daughter. And from this, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was quite delighted because obviously, as we said, it served his purpose. So he went away and basically the engagement was broken. So she was more or less fixed to someone. And as we said, up to today, there are people who fix up their little children in marriage from a very young age. I'm sure you have come across some of these incidents. Perhaps the new generation might not have heard about it. Ask your parents. They will tell you it's true. And sometimes nowadays, people mention it jokingly. Before, it was serious. If they had said this, that's it. When you grow old, you know what happens? You got to get married exactly where your parents wanted. You had no say in it, unless you rejected. But you could not come and say, no, I want to get married there. You had to get married where they wanted. If not, they would choose another place for you. If not, they would choose a third place for you. And it was always them who chose. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. May He make us understand also the happiness of our parents, and at the same time may He make us parents who also look at the happiness of our own children, because wallahi it is a give and take, in the sense that we need to understand what Allah wants and we need to understand what is good for us. If parents are wrong, they would be wrong, and if children are wrong, they would be wrong, because what is right is adopting the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Aisha radiallahu anha, she was married to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when she was very young. Narrations make mention of the age of 6, and some make mention of the age of 7. And this means that the aqd, or the solemnization of the nikah, was done, but they did not live together. She was still in the house of her father until after they got to Medina Munawwara, and thereafter, after some time, they lived together. But this point was very important, because a lot of people question the age of Aisha radiallahu anha. How can this be? And how bad is the messenger? Astaghfirullah, a'udhu billah. How bad would he have been in order to have done this? Wallahi, there is nothing bad about it. It was the norm of the time. And at the same time, it was more of what we would term today. We nowadays term an engagement as people having been fixed. They are fixed together. This, the nikah, was done. We have a lesson to learn from it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us those who do not have prolonged engagements, but rather those who can get the nikah done as soon as possible and thereafter get together. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us happiness in our homes. We also spoke about the first muhajir, the first person who made hijrah for the sake of Allah to Medina Munawwara, the story of Abu Salama and Ummu Salama radiyallahu anha, Hind bint Abi Umayyah, according to the narrations, that was her name. And later on, she was married to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When her husband passed away, she endured a lot. She, as we mentioned, she was separated from her husband as well as from her little child. And only after a year, or a little bit more than a year, did she become united once again with them, and was she permitted to go back, or to go to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. Then we have the first muhajirin also. We must make mention of their names. Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. He had already gone after the first Aqaba, the first pledge of Aqaba. He had gone to Medina Munawwara in order to teach them the deen. And we said that he had come back to Makkah al-Mukarramah with the news of the people of Medina and so on to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From amongst the early muhajirin, Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum, Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu anhu. These people went after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam announced to them that you can now proceed to Medina Munawwara. We are definitely going in that direction. The question arises, why didn't Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lead the way? Look at it. Ironically, today, when there is a country under threat or leaders are in trouble, they are the first ones who go. And the people are made to suffer. They abscond and they run away. And the people are made to suffer. With the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I need to make mention, it was the other way around. He made sure everyone went. He waited for the permission of Allah for him to go personally. So Allah had granted permission for the companions to leave, but not for him. Subhanallah. And this is why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum make mention of a powerful fact regarding war. They knew that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what they used to say, كنا إذا اشتد البأس اتقينا برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Whenever there was a war and it became hot, you know, heated, very tense, we all went behind Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. He was in the front. Imagine, this was the messenger, because they knew we have to be protected here. Today it's the other way around. The leaders, you don't see them. They get away, and thousands and hundreds of thousands of their people die and are killed, and they are still having a fat life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw his companions leaving. From amongst them was Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, Ammar ibn Yasir, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu left with quite a few men. According to some narration, he had left with a few people, and there is a narration, as we said, we like to authenticate. There is a narration that says that he stood in Quraysh and he made an announcement in Quraysh, you see, the rest of the people were going ducking and diving. Quraysh was blocking some of them, stealing the wealth of some of them, blocking, kidnapping some of them, and Quraysh was hassling them. It is narrated in one narration that Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu got up and made an announcement saying that whoever wants their children to be orphaned or their wives to be widowed, I'll see you in that place there in the valley. Come and try and see what you want to do. Look at the words. However, that narration, the chain of it, for your information, is not authentic. You see, we make mention of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. He was a powerful man. But there is an authentic narration which is narrated in Sahih Muslim and various other books that make mention of, in fact, Ibn Kathir has made mention of it as well in his tafsir with an isnad, a chain that is acceptable. He says, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he wanted to make hijrah, they were persecuting the people severely. The people of Quraysh had got together and they were persecuting in a very systematic way, blocking, stopping, stealing the wealth off, and somehow trying to stop them and so on, kidnapping. So him and two of his friends, which made three of them, it was Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, Ayyash ibn Abi Rabi'ah, and Hisham ibn al-As. These were three people. They had got together and they decided, look, we're going to collect our provisions and we are going to leave at a specific time. Let's meet at that particular time at this particular place just on the outskirts of Makkah. And whoever from amongst us does not come, it means that that particular person has been held back by Quraysh. The rest of us will carry on. So at the particular time, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu arrived there. Ayyash ibn Abi Rabi'ah, he arrived there as well. But the third one, Hisham ibn al-As, did not arrive. When he did not arrive, the two understood that, you know what? We need to make tracks and we need to get going. So the two of them got going and they arrived in Medina Munawwara. It is reported that when they got to Quba, and that's where the base of the Muhajirin had been so far, the bulk of them, a lot of them, Abu Jahl and Al-Harith ibn Hisham from Quraysh had gone all the way to Medina Munawwara. Imagine. And this is a correct, authentic narration. They went because Ayyash ibn Abi Rabi'ah was a man whom they didn't want to lose. So they spoke to him in Quba. And they had said, you know what? Your mother has promised that she will not eat and she will not do this and do that until she sees you, so you better come back. So he felt it because he was quite close to his mother. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu says they are lying. They just want to get you, kidnap you and sort you out. He says, no, no, my mother. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu says, look, I am telling you, these people are liars. They have come to block you and to disturb you and to remove you from the deen that you have now followed. So he said, no, inshallah, I'll go. I'll sort my things out. I've got money with someone and I will come back very soon. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu gave him the animal and said, look, this animal is faster, quicker and better than yours. Take this and go. So when he went, as they were on the road and they were at a certain place, Abu Jahl and his friend Al-Harith ibn Hisham, they told him, look, you know, our camel, there is a problem here with it, so why don't you stop and let me ride on yours? When he stopped, got down, they kidnapped him, tied him, put him onto the back of the camel, took him to Makkatul Mukarrama, and they kept him in that particular place. They suffocated him. At the same time, they punished him, penalized him, until news got around that this man has left his faith. News went to Medina Munawwara that this man has now returned to the religion of the forefathers, shirk and polytheism and so on. And the same news arrived about the third person who was supposed to have joined Umar ibn al-Khattab and Ayyash ibn Abi Rabi'ah, and his name was Hisham ibn al-As. So news had got to them that these two had reneged from Islam and turned away. Later on, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had come, verses were revealed. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابُ ثُمَّ لَا تُنْصَرُونَ. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O my worshippers, meaning O worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have transgressed against themselves Never lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for indeed, He forgives all sins. He is most forgiving, most merciful. Turn to Him before it is too late, before a day comes to you of punishment, and then you will not be helped. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu wrote these verses and sent them to his two friends, Hisham ibn al-As and Ayyash ibn Abi Rabi'ah. And Hisham makes mention of how when he read it, he knew that this is revealed because of me. He was pacing by the Tuwa, a name of a place close to Makkatul Mukarramah. And he was pacing up and down, and he knew this was for him. And after some time, they had been released and they went to Medina Al-Munawwara at a certain stage. So this was also part of the suffering of some of those who had intended to engage in Hijrah. There was one who engaged also, whom we need to mention his name, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Remember the powerful man. The powerful man, the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Believe me, they all made hijrah. They were instructed by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to leave. And the bulk of them left. Makkah started becoming quiet. It started becoming quiet. And the mushriks became very eerie, as we will see in a few moments. But there was one man who wanted to make hijrah, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopped him. Who was that? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Don't make haste, O Abu Bakr. Don't make haste, O Abu Bakr, in going for the hijrah." And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu understood that this means perhaps he would then go with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the day he left. Also Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, who was much younger than them, was also from amongst those who were instructed to stay. And the reasons were many. One of them was revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another was that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had a strange relation with the mushriks of Quraysh, in that they didn't agree with his message, but they trusted him the most. All of them who had anything valuable, who wanted it for safekeeping, went to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though they were at loggerheads with him, and they used to say, "You know, you're a trustworthy man, just keep this." How many of us, if an enemy had to come to us, and we had some of his wealth, or he came and said, "You know what, I just want to entrust you with this 1 million rands, just hold it for me." What would happen? I think before we know it, as we're counting it, it will become 900,000. Allah protect us. And we count it again, it becomes 800,000. That's the famous one, mashallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What an honest, upright man. That even his own enemies bore witness that he was honest. And this is why he said to them, "Oh my people, do you think I would lie to you? If I were to lie, I wouldn't ever lie about what I'm just telling you now." Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all and grant us goodness. So Ali radiallahu anhu as well, he had stayed behind. Now, the mushriks of Quraysh, as I said, they became very wary of the situation, and they were pacing up and down. They were very, very unsettled because they were faced with a problem. What was the problem? They had a meeting in a place known as Darun Nadwa. Darun Nadwa was this place where all their planning and plotting used to happen. Quraysh, whatever big decisions they wanted to arrive at, were all made in Darun Nadwa. It was the house of Qusay ibn Kilab. He was one of the members of Quraysh. And at his house, they called it Darun Nadwa. They got together in order to decide, what should we do with this Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So some of them said, "Let us confine him. Let us confine him and keep him, kidnap him and seal him completely, so no one can come and no one can go and no one will know where he is." That was one plan. The next plan, they said, others said, "No, no, no, we cannot do that. The reason is, if we confine him, now he has followers in Yathrib, which is Medina, and most of his companions are there. They will prepare an army and come to release him from kidnap. So there's no point in kidnapping him." So look at how that plan also failed. From themselves, they disagreed with it. After that, they said, "Okay, let's kick him out. Let's boot him out of this place. No problem. Allow him to leave." And the other said, "How can you let him leave? If he leaves, he's going to go to Medina Munawwara. He's going to become powerful. People who listen to his words are all accepting. Everybody is accepting, and the numbers are only growing, they are not diminishing. So they will prepare an army in a short time and they will come to attack us. How can we let him go? So they said, no, don't let him go. Okay, that's plan B. It failed itself because they found fault in it. Plan C, let us just kill him. Now if we kill him, his followers will come and they will still come and attack us. But this perhaps might be a good idea if we think of how to do it. So how did they want to do it? They said, look, this Quraysh is made up of so many different tribes, different little clans. So we have Banu Hashim, Banu this, Banu that, Banu Abd Manaf and so on. He is from Banu Abd Manaf. If we were to kill him, Banu Abd Manaf can come and wage war against the killers. But if there are so many killers, one from every tribe, then this Banu Abd Manaf will never be able to come out and fight everyone. They can't fight the whole of Quraysh. So what happened is, subhanallah, they decided, okay, what we do is tomorrow. Tonight we will send one strong man from every single clan of ours and we'll encircle his home. And then what will happen is, as he emerges from his house in the morning, we whack him all together. And who will be to blame? The whole lot. So one from every single tribe, and Banu Abd Manaf will not be able to revenge or retaliate. They will have to accept some blood money, and the blood money will be very little because we are going to divide it amongst all of us here. So that's how they planned to kill him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah informed him of everything. He knew what was exactly planned. And you see the time when he told Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu not to make haste. At that time, Abu Bakr was very intelligent. He immediately purchased two camels and he made sure he fed them well so that they would be strong for a long journey. Look at the intelligence of the man. Subhanallah. He started preparing for the journey. This was before all this. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had told him, don't make haste, he understood. He already purchased the animals and started preparing them. Now on that day, suddenly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who does not normally come out during the daylight to visit people, he visited Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu in his home in the heat of the afternoon. The heat of the afternoon. And he was covered and he was walking quick. He knocked on the door, it opened. Oh, it's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha radiallahu anha says, we saw him come in. And when he came in, obviously this was his wife, but they had not yet lived together. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, welcomed him and sat down. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever is in this home, tell them to leave, because there was something important to discuss. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu says, there are none other than my own family, my own daughters, they are here, no one else. So then he spoke immediately, few words. He says, look, Allah has given me permission to leave. Subhanallah. So this was what they were waiting for, permission to leave. Without permission, they were not allowed to leave. Now this was in the month of Safar, towards the end of Safar. It is reported the 27th of Safar, somewhere near the end of Safar. And Allah had instructed me to leave. Most of the companions had already gone. So what I need you to do, O Abu Bakr, is the following. We will meet at this particular cave. We will meet at a specific place. And that is where the two of us will get together. Or better still, according to some narrations, I will come to you by night. And the two of us will get together and we will leave. We will go to a cave and spend some time in the cave right on the outskirts of Makkah. Because as soon as Quraysh knows that we have left, they are going to send little armies and little groups of people all around to go in various directions to look for us. If we're on the road at the time, they're going to catch us. And if we are somewhere where they cannot see, then they will not be able to catch us at all. And they won't even find out. They will give up hope. So we will wait there. And then they had a guide whom they needed, because the road, it was difficult. As I told you yesterday, people needed a guide. Those who were not very used to the road would have needed a guide. So subhanallah, Abdullah ibn Urayqit, he was a man who was a mushrik, but he was an honest, upright guide. And he was a person whom they had trusted. So they sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hired him and told him the following. Look, we want you to meet us at this cave in 3 days' time. That's it. Subhanallah. So he didn't know too many details. All he knew is, I will meet these people at this cave 3 days' time. And here are the two camels. Take them with you and you bring them when you come. So he took the camels. So in the meantime, Ali radiallahu anhu was instructed by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look, tonight you will sleep in my bedding here in my home. And in the morning, you will get up as usual, and I have so many items of value which belong to Quraysh that they have kept with me, and everything is properly recorded. You need to take all these things and give them back to whomsoever they belong to, so that nothing is left in my home that belongs to someone else. So that was one of the reasons why he was kept there as well. Because if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had gone to give back Quraysh their things, they would have blocked him. They would have known he's leaving. So the fact that he still had the items, some of Quraysh doubted, thinking that this man couldn't have gone with all our things. He is very trustworthy. See? So this was also part of the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the meantime, the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Asma'a binti Abi Bakr, she had made up with her belt two little holding, meaning food holders, and she used to take the food to that cave. When they got to the cave, inshallah, we will still get to that. But she was the one who brought the food up and down from the cave to the cave from the home. Now, that evening, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in his home. And as per the plan of Quraysh, these men had come and encircled the house. Ali radiallahu anhu was in with him, subhanallah. And they knew the man is inside. They were happy. So as night fell, some of them were tired and some of them were this and that, and they were not really concentrating. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was instructed by Allah to leave the home. When he left the home, according to one of the narrations, he was reading verses of Surah Yasin, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ. He took a small little hand of dust and he just threw it just as into the air. And by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every one of those young men who were waiting to snap at him happened to have some grit in their eyes from the dust he threw. Now the meaning of the verse of Surah Yasin, and we have placed a bar before them and a bar behind them, and we have covered them so that they cannot see. That's the meaning of the verse. So as he read the verse and he threw this little handful of dust, they all at one time began to rub their eyes. Now you tell me, if you were rubbing your eyes now, how would you know who else is rubbing their eyes? You wouldn't know. So all of them at the same time, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stepped out and he was gone. Out to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu's home, and the two of them left for the cave. In no time they were in that cave. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu went in first in order to look. It was at the top of Mount Thawr. Mount Thawr, I'm sure those who visited Mecca have been shown, just on the outskirts of Makkah al-Mukarramah. And when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu went in to see that there is no snake or nothing harmful inside, thereafter Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went in and the two of them camped there. They waited there. In the meantime, it's important to know what happened there, back at home. Ali radiallahu anhu was covered with the clothing of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he got up, and the narrations make mention of how when he stepped out, they were so excited until they found out, this is Ali ibn Abi Talib. So where is the man? The man is not here. Where is he? I don't know. Perhaps he's gone somewhere. But how could this be? We were watching all along and we saw him in here. Subhanallah. And where is the man? Gone. So news spread in the morning across Quraysh that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is gone. He's gone. What did they do? They became mental. They became mad. They started preparing little groups of people. Go this way, go search that way, go search this way. And they heard Abu Bakr is with him. They announced in Quraysh, we will give 100 camels to anyone who brings this man back, dead or alive. 100 camels. And the same applies to his companion, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. According to some narrations, the one for either one of them. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us the way he protected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Quraysh were very intelligent. Now, a point of importance is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu had one of his servants by the name of Amir ibn Fuhayra. And this man, he was a shepherd servant, and he used to take the sheep to graze. He was instructed that you must graze your sheep near this cave. And one of the reasons would be that you see the footsteps of these men who walked to the cave will be looked at by Quraysh. Once you have sheep walk all over it, it becomes very difficult for them to notice. Look at the planning. Look at the planning so perfect, subhanallah, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this Amir ibn Fuhayra, he took his sheep and they walked all over these footsteps and so on. But Quraysh, they were too intelligent. They had their intelligence, so they were looking all over until some sort of signs led them to the cave. And this all was a plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us a lesson here today. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He protects you, wallahi, wallahi, nobody can harm you. Not at all. And believe me, people can become blinded that you are standing there. And people can become blinded from your wealth that they are trying to steal, although it will be glaring them in their faces. That is if Allah wills. He has done it and He continues doing it. May Allah protect us. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the cave with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the two of them were there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of what happened in that particular cave. إِلَّا تَنصُرُوهُ فَقَدْ نَصَرَهُ اللَّهُ إِذْ أَخْرَجَهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا ثَانِيَ اثْنَيْنِ إِذْ هُمَا فِي الْغَارِ إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا فأنزل الله سكينته عليه وأيده بجنود لم تروها. الله أكبر. Allah says, if you are not going to assist Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah has helped him in the past when there were two of them in the cave, and his companion, who is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, was told, do not fear, Allah is with us. Do not fear, Allah is with us. And Allah says, we sent to them armies that were not seen. We sent to them armies that were not seen. Allah protected them. Quraysh, their members had got right to the mouth of the cave. They were quite convinced that this is roughly the track where these people are. Because they looked up and down these roads and pathways going to Medina, there was no one. They looked in other directions as well, no sign. So this was the only thing. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu looks at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, if these people have to look down, they will see us. If these people have to look properly, they will see us. And this is when Allah says that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was instructed to tell him, la tahzan, don't be sad, inna allaha ma'ana, Allah is with us. So the verse says, fa'anzalallahu sakinatahu alayhi. Allah then sent down the tranquility and the peace upon him, upon not only his messenger, who was already that, but even Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was calm and relaxed. Now there is mention made of a spider and a dove. There is mention made in the books of history, not in the books of hadith. I hope you can see the difference between the two. The books of history make mention of a spider that spun its web in a way that the people of Quraysh, it is said, they asked a question. How can they be in here if there is a spider web? Because a spider web wouldn't be here already. It would have needed some time. So it shows, you know, when you walk into your home and there's all webs, it means there's been no one there for a while. And the same applies to a nest of a little pigeon or dove. But for your information, as for the pigeon or dove, even the books of history make mention that the narration is not authentic. And as for the spinning of the web, it is made mention in the books of Seerah, but not in the books of Hadith. And the Muhaddithin still say that it is highly debatable, although some of the scholars say, no, it is authentic. For me and you, Alhamdulillah, we surrender, say, Allah protected them with armies, and Allah's armies include the birds and the spiders and the angels and anyone else whom Allah wants. What happened is they were protected. Subhanallah. So Alhamdulillah, Quraysh then looked this way, that way, and turned around. When they turned around and went away, and after some time on the third day, what happened? This man comes with the two camels. By the third day, the hunt had been already, you know, calmed down, and all the hype of it was all gone. And now this man, Abdullah ibn Urayqit, he comes with the two camels, and he is ready to pick up Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In the meantime, for the amount of days, what was happening is the son of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, who was a young boy, Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr, he was tasked with something by his father. His father told him as he was leaving, listen my son, during the daytime you must walk around by Quraysh, see what they're saying about us and what's happening, and bring us some news in the night. And this young boy used to actually do that, so this was just to find out what was happening and to know that these people heading in the wrong direction and in that direction and this and that and so on. So then they had given up at a certain point. And then, as we mentioned, the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu came to help Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his father with some food. And this had happened, she used to come quietly walking out and then she would go and deliver the food, come back and so on. This was the group of people, mainly made up of the family of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. When the day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told him in his home that I have been permitted to leave, the first thing he said, As-suhbatu ya Rasulallah, can I be your companion or messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam? He said, yes indeed. And this is when he became the companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we believe not only the companion in his life, but even in the death, he is buried right next to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the best of those who tread this earth after the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So thereafter, they started their journey, and alhamdulillah, the journey was a beautiful journey, which the guide intelligently took them on a different route altogether, not on the normal route. Because he realized these people are going to Medina, let me take them on a longer route on the coast, the coastal road. And this is why today people can actually choose to use the old road which goes via Badr and so on to go back into Makkatul Mukarramah from Medina or vice versa. Although the highway is built more or less straight. But when it comes to the old road, it's not even the road which was taken by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because that one was never developed as such later on. It is further in and it follows the coast. So as they were traveling, some miracles happened which we must make mention. One of the first miracles that had happened, subhanallah, news had got around everywhere. Quraysh had sent their horsemen here and there telling everyone 100 camels. 100 camels is a big deal. It's like me telling you $100 million, basically. A large amount of money. And everyone, subhanallah, was looking out for these people because we are going to get 100 camels. 100 camels we are going to get. And there was a certain place where a man who was a bounty hunter. You know what's a bounty hunter? A person who looks for this type of thing and then he goes and hunts for those people and brings them dead or alive to make the money out of it. His name was Suraqah ibn Malik. This Suraqah ibn Malik was sitting amongst his friends, and one comes up and says, you know what? On that particular road on the coast, I'm sure I saw some people, and that must be Muhammad and his companions. And you know, so Suraqah heard it. Very sharp, intelligent man. He immediately said, no, that's somebody else. I know those people. It's somebody else. It's not them, and so on. And the topic died. As soon as that happened, he got up, got his horse, and he ran. So he was cheating. He actually knew that yes, it might be, but to divert the man who brought the news and to get the money for himself and the camels for himself, what did he say? He said, no, it's not them. I know it's not them. And then as soon as that man turned around and everything died down a little bit, this man goes and he is racing with his horse. He's racing with his horse and he sees them and he notices from amongst them, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not looking back. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu looks back now and again. And as he sees them, his horse trips and drops. And then he gets it up, he gets back up on it and he starts going again. And the horse has slowed down and it's like it doesn't want to move. And narration, subhanallah, Suraqah bin Malik, he makes mention of it later on as well. And what happened is, this man says, after some time when I was about to get to them, I got through some quicksand and my horse started sinking in the sand. And so I got off the horse and I managed to take this horse out with great difficulty. By that time, these people had gone even further. And I got onto it and I started going again. And as I'm going, a huge cloud of dust comes up and some smoke, as I couldn't even see what was happening from the skies. And I told myself, no, these people, I'm never going to reach them. This man is protected. This man is protected. Subhanallah. This is a miracle. And what had happened is, Suraqa bin Malik then yells, he screams in a way that they can hear. He says, look, I promised not to harm you, and at the same time, I would not like harm from you. I want a guarantee, and you are guaranteed. So they slowed down, they managed to get hold of him, and he came, and they spoke to each other, and he gave them the news. What was the news? You people are being sought after. There is 100 camels behind you. Obviously, there was now a guarantee, I'm not going to touch you. But what's going to happen? I'm going to go back. Can you give me a note to guarantee me and my safety? Because now that I've met you, what if some of your people see me? Whatever it was, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was instructed by the messenger to write a little note of guarantee for this particular man. And Suraqa bin Malik, it's reported that thereafter he went away. This man did not become a Muslim. He saw the miracles. But the day when the Muslims returned to Makkah victorious, that's the day he accepted Islam. This Suraqa bin Malik. And then we found out what happened in his life and the whole story. He says it himself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. So Allah protected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that way. The next miracle that had happened, there was a lady in a place known as Qudayd, and her name was Atika binti Khalaf, also known as Ummu Ma'bad. And there are two narrations. One of them says that Abu Ma'bad, who is the man, the husband, was not at home. And the other one says, no, he was at home. And the more correct narration says he was at home. So what happened is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they stopped at a specific place here in Qudayd, and they asked for some food and some drink and so on. And they were told, look, you know what? We don't have any here. We've only got these sheep that are here that do not have much. They don't have any milk, and some of them are pregnant and so on. They don't have milk. Now, up to that point, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's group, meaning the group of people who were with the guide Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu an, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were very, very careful answering questions. When someone asks Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, who is the man with you? He would say, he's my guide. My guide meaning spiritual guide. But they would think the guide of the road. Yet he was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they wanted to know, who's this man? And he was obviously in such a way that people would not see him. If they did not trust someone, then they wouldn't unnecessarily turn around and so on. Like we heard what Suraqa bin Malik says, that this man did not turn, but Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu kept turning every now and again. So at this point, when they stopped for a little bit of food and drink, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke, and he says to Abu Ma'bad. One narration says Abu Ma'bad was not there, so he spoke to Ma'bad. But we will go with the more authentic narration. He spoke to Abu Ma'bad and he says, what about this sheep that's there? He says, look, it's dry. There's no milk at all. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, would you mind if I try to milk it? So the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told, no problem, you can milk it. When it came, he put his hand on the udders. He made a dua for barakah and goodness. And suddenly the udders became full. He milked it. So much milk came out. They all drank. The family drank. The people drank. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq drank. They all drank. They were okay. And when they were finished drinking, he milked it according to the narration once again for a surplus of milk. Subhanallah. And this Abu Ma'bad looks and says, are you not the man that Quraysh is looking for? You are not the man who has reneged from the religion of the forefathers. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, within his heart, he knew that this person here is about to enter the fold of Islam. So he said, well, so they say that I was a renegade and I did this and that, and I am the man they're looking for. He says, I bear witness that you are a prophet. You are the messenger. I have seen. That's it. Subhanallah. Amazing. The other narration says that he was away, but this happened to his wife. And when his wife told him what happened, he said, and I will follow him if I can, inshallah. But the more correct narration says, he immediately said, can I not join you people? You're going to Medina, Hijrah, come, I'm coming. I'll pack up my things and myself and wife will come with you. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, no, wait until the day you hear about us. When you hear that we have now come up, then you can come to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwarah. And true to his word, he did make it there after some time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness. This was another miracle that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was granted. Also, it is reported in some correct narrations that Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, as he was coming back from his journey and his travel, had met this caravan of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We say caravan, we're speaking of two camels, perhaps a third one. And he met them and he gave them some clothing and so on. This was Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, who was a sahabi, radiyallahu anhu, returning from one of his journeys. Then comes the historic occasion when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on a Monday arrived in Quba, the outskirts of Medina Munawwara, from a distance. Every day the people used to come out and look, where are these people? Perhaps we'll see them. On that day they had waited, it was quite a hot day and they were all gone back. And as the heat became very intense, subhanallah, a Jewish man who had climbed up saw, and he says, "You know what? There is your man. You know, this, the term used is like grandfather has arrived. You know, your man has arrived here." And so they all got excited. This was Quba. Quba, the outskirts of Medina Munawwara. And mashallah, tabarakallah, they all came up. And some of them had got their swords in order to protect Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just in case something went wrong. And they went up and they were so happy. They got to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They got to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And being so excited, welcoming them, declaring their shahada, declaring the words of, you know, Ya Muhammad, Ya Rasulullah, and so on. These were the people of Quba having come out. The Muhajirin from amongst them, the Ansar from amongst them, those who were helpers from Medina Munawwara. And they had come out. It is reported this, the arrival. There are many conflicting narrations as per the date of arrival. But one of the most authentic narrations states that it was a Monday, the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. Have you heard that date before somewhere? Subhanallah. Coinciding similarly to similar date as the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he arrived in Quba. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Just to make quick mention of where he spent his time whilst he was in Quba. In Quba, he stayed between 14 and 19 days. And he stayed at the house of one of the leaders of Banu Amr, whose name was Kulthum ibn al-Hidim. And this man was one of the leaders. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed in his home. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met with his people. And lots of goodness was spoken. Now he was already protected by the people of Medina Munawwara. Obviously, over and above that was the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he did one thing quite quickly. And that was, he built a masjid. He built the first masjid with his own hands, and the companions helped him. And that is Masjid Quba. If we go to Medina Munawwara, we will see it. And they built a simple structure so that the Muslims could pray, and so that they could gather, and so that they could meet, and so that they could learn more about their faith. And they built a structure which was not a beautiful structure, but the hearts of the people who attended were beautiful. Today it's the opposite. Structure is beautiful. Are the hearts of the people who attend as beautiful? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us guidance until we meet again. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد سبحان الله بحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.